the Extinction Agenda, comics of the 80s, 90s, and more.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Although that was really good, though. Do that again. yeah, special edition. Episode something, something, something with Chris. We're talking about the Marshal Law.
Marshal Law.
By Mr. Pat Mills, and as you were saying a moment ago, illustrated by Kevin O'Neill. Let's see. He did some of the coloring as well with Mark Chiarello.
He worked with Alan Moore. I didn't realize that when I was reading this.
Oh, yeah, the Kevin O'Neill. Yeah.
Yeah.
All the League of Extraordinary Gentlemen shit.
Yeah. Like, that's good. That's good stuff.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. He's got a pedigree. Well, I mean, basically, he's just a British guy that works with a bunch of people from 2000 AD. But, you know, that's more or less what he gets up to. I don't know if he's done any other work with people outside that sphere.
Okay. And Pat Mills began at 2000 AD, I take it.
He founded 2000 AD. I would do a little bit more elbow work, but I've been busy. But in my understanding, so he worked in Boys Military Comics for a while. Like, I think he started off in romance, and then he ended up in the military, section. And then his sort of claim to fame was that he was like, he turned military comics into, he gave them more of a middle class feel, and he upped the action on them. And they sold like hotcakes. And then he requested, if I remember correctly, can I start something like 2000 AD? And then, he brought us Judge Dredd and all that other good stuff. Okay. And pretty much the entire British wave of American writers came through those doors.
Wow, I probably should have known that before we did this. But that's amazing. And like the middle class military comics have nothing to do with martial law, which is pretty.
No, amazing. Not at all.
This is not that at all.
Yeah. Yeah, he's dealing with some stuff. So I'd never read this. And you hadn't either. It had been on my radar as like people talk about it as one of the things of the 80s, you know, like yeah. There's, you know, like, you know, American flag and that sort of thing. And, I don't know. It was just an itch that I always wanted to scratch. So
you can understand
thanks.
Why. I mean, it's, obviously incredibly influential. There's good stuff in it. Like I was saying to you, like if I had to rate this, someone forced me to like rate it, I'd give it a B minus for effort.
That's totally fair.
Yeah. It's like, I've never read something where like, if I looked at it with one eye, if I close one eye, like I'm seeing something amazing. If I close the other, like I can make fun of it. I kind of have the metaphor that it's kind of like, I was thinking that going to the optometrist and they put that like metal visor on your face. And, you know, when you start, it's totally blurry and you're like, what the fuck am I looking at? But then they adjust it and you see it clearly and you're like, okay, there's something here. But in this case, it's almost like you're in a mind control device in the first place and it was actually shitty all along, but it's an interesting kind of shitty. So yeah, I definitely didn't regret reading it.
I don't think I come down that hard, actually. Strangely, I was a little touched at the end. Go on.
The final issue is really good. Like but I don't think it's earned, and I'll definitely have some things to say about that.
Yeah. What I was going to say, though, is that I disliked this book a lot up until like page 93.
Yeah.
Maybe even like even into the second issue, I was like, what the fuck does everybody like about this story? Like the action's incomprehensible. Like it looks amazing. Like it's atmospheric. It's interesting. But I don't know what's happening. And it's just weird. There's just a lot of nothing happening. A lot of martial law just killing superheroes and talking about how he hates them.
Yeah, a lot of dumb quips, like just like really shitty writing.
But then after 93, I started to realize that it was a noir. And that, you know, this is superhero Chinatown in a big way. And then I was like, okay, yeah, like it's, you know, it's a mystery, it's a detective story. But it's all about the, I don't know, the destruction of illusions and myths and things.
Yeah. I saw it as almost a takedown. Not a takedown, but like just answering back at Frank Miller. Although I think Dark Knight might have been so close to this that maybe the influence would have, like, maybe it's almost at the same time.
I don't even think you need Dark Knight for it. I mean, because Daredevil would have preceded this. But yeah, it does feel like a response to Dark Knight, but at the same time, I think they're concurrent. When's the dates? We're looking. Oh no, they're okay. I'm sorry. It's October 1987 to March 1988. Yeah. Okay. Dark Knight's definitely been out by this point. Dark Knight so.
Was 86, right?
I think so. At the very least, it was completed by 86. Yeah. So yeah. It everybody had some time to get that flavor and. Yeah, I see that. I see that very clearly now.
Yeah. And in issue 4, there's like the, not to get too far ahead, but there's just one of the the California Bastards, which is a gang that's kind of like moved into the city to take things down. What the main boss looks very much like the mutant that's kind of the main villain in Dark Knight, that kind of like the bald guy, like the giant hulking mutant thing.
Yeah, with the sharp teeth. I'm looking at a picture of him right now. He's on the front cover of, I guess, issue 3.
Yeah.
and then you turn the page and the public spirit is, he's taking his drugs. He's got a needle deep in his veins. I was like,
that's the lamest fucking scandal. Those simpler times, man. The public spirit does anabolic steroids. It's like, I don't know. Watch enough baseball that like doesn't faze me anymore.
So I don't know where you need to be, where we should begin. I mean, like, I don't think there's much value in going sort of chronologically.
Maybe there's some, because like the plot is so simple that it's pretty easy to recount.
Yeah,
and I'm sure it'll lead us into the bigger issues.
Yeah. So you know, Marshal Law makes his appearance, and he's some cross between a BDSM enthusiast and I don't know, like a Nazi lieutenant. You know, he's got the trench coat, and actually, no, he doesn't have a trench coat, but he's got that hat. There's something very fascist about how he's dressed. Definitely the hat.
I wrote down he's like an SS gimp.
Yeah. And, you know, he's armed to the teeth, and he's out there battling other, you know, they refer to them as superheroes. You know, this is basically like a, you know, it's someone who's been in the industry, Pat Mills, you know, coming over to America and just finding he really hates superheroes and taking a little bit of, I guess, Judge Dredd over there and just beating the fuck out of them. Now that I've said that out loud, this is very Judge Dredd. It makes me think, so one of the things that the Warren Ellis talks about, and other writers who have come over, Jamie Delano and those guys, they talk about coming over from Britain and entering into the Western comics atmosphere, you know, the industry, and where it's superhero dominated. But over there, it's, you know, it's war comics. It's 2000 AD. It's wild shit. Where the main hero is a straight up fascist, Judge Dredd, you know, judge, jury, executioner, I am the law, all that shit. Like that's their Superman over there, in a lot of ways. And so for them to come over here, you know, they just found it so ridiculous.
That's culture shock for sure.
Yeah. And this book, I, you know, reading it, it just feels like, and for a lot of ways, this story feels like that boy who grew up reading military comics and created Judge Dredd and then came over, and this is his, like, him giving expression to just how stupid he all thinks it is.
Yeah, I think there's something very real too. And I mean, like, we might as well get out of the way. This is obviously a huge influence on The Boys and Garth Ennis.
But that
basic sort of, like, just like it's incredulous that the idea that if you were given unlimited power that you would do good with it instead of being a corrupt asshole, which is I don't think I've seen that trope before this comic. So I'm interested in it as a piece of comic history for that reason.
Mm-hmm.
But just the fact that, like, all of them are corrupt and just kind of like just exploiting people and like just sleaze bags is really fun.
Yeah, and it's I don't know what I was just thinking, looking at the book, either that or they're pathetic. It's not just that they're, you know, that the superheroes are necessarily evil or twisted. You know, some of them are mentally ill. Some of them are you know, severely disabled.
Yeah.
Like it's, and then the rest are, I don't know, they're the royal family. And that gets to The Boys thing. But they didn't even Garth Ennis. You know, like The Boys, let's say that this book didn't exist. Everything that I said earlier about Pat Mills applies equally, if not more so, to Garth Ennis.
That's
so for him to come in, he spent like the early 2000s just making fun of superheroes. Even before The Boys, you know, like his Punisher run is like his first one was hilarious and always a send up.
Yeah. Hitman 2 with the kind of like wacky, just like he has such a knack for creating these ridiculous characters like Defenestrator and Dog Welder. Just like this is their power. He welds dogs to people. Like it's the same thing as like all this superhero shit you're throwing at me.
Yeah, we just reread, or for the first time read some Hitman. It's going to be the next episode that comes out.
Oh, nice.
It's not, it does, the issues we read didn't, they weren't like the full-on making fun of superheroes thing, but one day we're going to get over to The Boys and talk about that. Marshal Law, he hates the superheroes. He's the, he's the policeman, and I guess he's in San Francisco?
Yeah, this world doesn't make sense to me. It's Mad Max, but it's like, so San Francisco is rough by an earth. Everything's in fucking shambles, but there's no, like, it seems like it's completely, it's Mad Max, basically. It's like Mad Max in San Francisco, but there's no sense that it's cut off from the rest of the world. Like, they talk about other places, and, like, it's unclear to me why this place is a gang wasteland, and nowhere else seems to be.
I think maybe this, it might be satire. You know, I'm just thinking about the conservative imagination and the conservative view of San Francisco as a den of iniquity and perversion and all that shit.
Oh, that's a good point. I didn't think about that, but you're probably right.
Yeah. And so, you know, it's the place where all of this goes down, and even thinking of Hollywood or California, like, basically this is the East Coast of America, through the imagination of your apocalyptic conspiracy.
Which spiritually it's already this is just like a slight bit further.
Yeah, so that's what I was thinking about that, and that again ties into the what I was thinking of as the Chinatown connection, because that also takes place on the West Coast. I think I said East Coast earlier, and in you know, I don't know. I think it's where does Chinatown take place? Is it in Las Vegas? Probably Los Angeles. Yeah, it's LA.
It's LA because it ties into the water scandal.
Right. And so this place is like LA as well. Probably LA is the thing that we should be thinking about most. But
it's got that history of being like, you know, the like Haight Ashbury and like the, you know, where kind of gay rights people were safe to express themselves. So definitely it fits into the conservative imagination that way. I think you're absolutely right.
Yeah. So he's killing the superheroes here. And in the background of all these stories is the public spirit. And he's sort of their Superman analogy. But, you know, but of course he's, you know, like we see in The Boys, he's corrupt, he's venal, he's ultra rich, and he's a scumbag.
Yeah, he's the public face of something awful, and he's just the sort of like nice veneer on all the corruption.
Yeah, and you know, getting back to that conservative, American conservative connection, like he's all, you know, he's socially conservative. You know, he hates homosexuality. He wants, you know, he preaches the family. You know, are you going to have kids if God wills it? You know, that sort of thing.
Yeah.
And in his interior monologue, he's very, you know, later on during the wedding, he'll be like, you know, be as, you know, spare me your cynicism. The gaudier it is, the more I love it. So his interiority is where, so it, on the exterior level, he represents the myth. And then on the interior level, he represents a selfish embrace of consumerism and, you know, flash over substance, which just makes him all the kind of grosser.
And to contrast that, Marshal Law, I mean, I feel like one of the flaws of this series is just the kind of amateurishness. Like things build, like we come to understand why Marshal Law looks the way he does, but it's really hard to figure that out for the first five issues. And I'm always wondering where he's going with it. We kind of find out that his costume is a public, sort of like a public rejection of all this corruption. He's like, he's kind of putting it on the surface, saying that appearances don't matter. Like what you think is the virtuous thing, like the public spirit is actually scum, and I'm going to dress like this and look completely like freakish, and that's, you know, it doesn't matter. I'm calling you out.
Yeah, and later on, you know, after he admits, like he even talks about the BDSM, you know, it says, sure, he looked clean cut and respectable, but you can't judge by appearances. If you did, you'd say I was a rapist.
Yeah, I was just going to call out that quote. That's a good one.
Yeah. But having said that, it still doesn't make any sense why he dresses this way. Like it's an interesting visual, and it says something, but like I don't know what it's saying, because like is it meant to be shaming to, you know, towards kink? You know, like, or is it, you know, like he's dressed like a fascist, submissive dominator, you know, like all in there.
I had to think about that a lot.
Yeah. You know, go ahead.
I was going to say, I read it over three times trying to figure that out. And I think I kind of have, like, he goes through three phases of costume and identity.
Yes.
At first he's the veteran. No. At first, he's in the zone, which is like sort of like there's a permanent war with Southern America, and superheroes were created in order to fight in this war and to kind of further the basically the pockets of Doc Shock, who kind of created superheroes. So he fought in that, and then became disillusioned and became the vet when he came back, and then like his costume got slightly darker, and I think there was another one before he became Marshal Law, which is sort of like the most like nightmarish of the costumes, I guess. Not nightmarish, but I don't know what the right word is, but just like confrontational. I don't know.
I'd be really disturbed if that guy came up, you know.
Yeah, exactly.
He's got spikes everywhere, and like fear and loathing on his stomach, liberty on his arm. He's all these lightning bolts.
And that never comes into play.
And he also has an upside down cross for a mouth. You know, he's, confrontational's fair. A lot of this comes from Kevin O'Neill, because I don't know if Pat would have written all this, you know, he just basically would have given the idea over to Kevin O'Neill and, just let her rip. And this is what came out. Kevin O'Neill has a really awful costume design sense, but it really suits him here.
Yeah.
you know, he's, so what I wanted to, so the first thing that, what's the guy's real name? Shit. Gilmore. His name's Joe Gilmore.
Yeah.
Yeah. He was a screaming eagle. And, you know, that was the name of, I guess, you know, the superhero special forces unit that, that he was part of. And it's, you know, and getting back to American comics, like one of the most pop, one of the more popular super, military comics of the, I guess it was the 40s and early 50s was the Blackhawks. And they had a symbol almost exactly like the Screaming Eagle guy has. And he's got sort of the Captain America shield face. So he's like, he's participating in the propaganda era of superheroes at that point. Like that's the iconography and that they're drawing on. Yeah. And then, yeah, he comes back. And then they talk about Argentina, like they went to war in, I think it was in Argentina. And, you know, and some scientist hothoused. They use the word hot housing, like 14 million people. and it's basically, you know, like South American hot housed. And like, that's the Nazis, man. Like that's the rumors, you know, like all those German national socialists who escaped Germany and went to South America. The idea here is that they created their Superman there.
And then pretty clearly a Nazi scientist too.
Yeah. He's this Dr. Strangelove sort of guy.
Yeah.
I guess maybe if we want to get an idea of why, this gets back to our, what I was thinking of, or what we were puzzling over about the costume, you know, if the origin of all of this is National Socialism, then him dressed as a fascist is probably the most appropriate thing in the entire world.
Yeah. I think he's like calling it out. Like, I think that's the idea.
Yeah. And yet at the same time, his Joe Gilmore, is, you know, he just wears like these tidy whitey shirts and these jeans, he's clean cut. And his girlfriend, Linda,
Lynn,
who's going to get fridged real bad. That's unfortunate.
Man, I have a lot to say about Lynn.
Yeah. So yeah, she's, you know, she researches, she's a graduate student writing about all these themes, and she doesn't suspect, you know, it's like, it's a weird way for this story to respect the superhero genre, to have the hero actually have a secret identity, and to be spoken of, you know, like it's this problem that Spider-Man would have, where like the girl that he's with would talk about creepy old Spider-Man. No, I hate him. And so that's pretty much what Joe's putting up with. And I don't know, it's perfect. You know, like it's great for drama. Like I understand why he picked it, but it's at the very same time also a little strange.
He's a good guy about it. And I think that's sort of what they're trying to convey is that, I think those scenes are important because it shows you that like everything about their society is corrupt, from the police commissioner down, and like they only hire martial law because it's sort of like PR. It's like if you see this guy running around busting criminals, then it makes it look like we're doing something, so that's good. But really you're part of the system. I think that's that Mill's way of trying to show that he's above it or beyond it is to show that deep in his heart he's like just like this decent guy, and he's, you know, whatever, he doesn't bother him that his girlfriend thinks that martial law is a fascist, because, and by having that connection there, it's like saying he's not really a fascist. Like he's trying to show you that there's something, even though he's an anti-hero, he's really trying to address something about the system.
Yeah, you know, that's fair. And he'll be shown to even though he's going to compromise his principles, such as they are, you know, his utter hatred of superheroes, you know, he does that in order for like $1 million that are going to go to some veterans, some disabled veterans,
right.
You know, guys he would have fought in the unfortunate war with. So yeah, there's, he's not irredeemable, and you honestly, I don't mind that he's killing a bunch of rampaging superheroes. Like, it doesn't feel wrong.
Yeah.
Yeah. He never bullies anyone.
That's the visceral thrill that Ennis will pick up on later with the boys. It's just like, when you have heroes that are this corrupt, it's fun to just have someone rampage against them. But he's not very good at, like, the first, so going back to the first action scene where he's kind of swooping down, he does like a little cart, he grabs the light post, he does a little, like, gymnastics flip around it, rescues the hero that these thugs, the gangrene and his gang are fucking up. And then he drops his gun, gets tasered by gangrene, and Kane is like his fucking spinach, man, because after that he just lifts a car and throws it at this gang, but that's pretty much the end of the fight.
And this is one of the things that it makes this issue feel disjointed, because he's like, pain, feel pain again. Yeah. I'm one. Thanks, guys. You know, and you never get the impression later on in the story, maybe I'm misremembering, that he's seeking pain. You know, I know that maybe that's not important, but say that again.
I think it's really important. I think the sort of the point of the bondage in S&M imagery, I wrote this down. So when in that part he says, he says literally, pain, feel pain again, thanks guys. And then he says, they gave us superpowers to win the war. Worst of all, he gave us power over pain. If you can't receive pain, you want to inflict it to see what you're missing. You become capable of anything. So all of these heroes have been kind of chewed up and spit out by this merciless prophet system. And they're just kind of, they're like, you know, it's the Nom thing. It's like the, these are the wreckage of men from this generation. And they, even though they're scum, he says they're just the symptom. I'm going after the disease. So it's that S&M dynamic is sort of like that, just that acknowledgement that pain is kind of making this world go around, and that there's it's critical to it.
Right. Okay. And I guess that also, I'm just thinking this through after hearing what you just said, and him going after the public spirit, treating the public spirit as the disease, that pure expression of what the American dream actually is, not what everybody thinks it is, but what it actually is, the overarching myth, which he doesn't think that he's a part of, but he is, as we know, as you've already said, but also from the interior dialogue of Commissioner McGlade, when they're calling him Rambo on a leash. And everything else that you had alluded to, and this ties in perfectly, because he too is a symptom, and he wants to punish himself as well, and the costume's sort of emblematic of that.
And as you said that, I was just thinking that. This is very much a comic about vigilantism, and. I want to say a little bit more about that later, but the Punisher is obviously another sort of figure that works in this genre. And so the idea of flipping that around, the punishment being sort of a punishment of yourself too, is it really, again, fits in perfectly with that.
Yeah. So dive into some of the other things you wanted to, let's get into vigilantism,
Maybe we should talk a bit about what the public spirits have done, and kind of why he's on this quest before we do that.
Sure. So he's, he's, near as I can remember, he's basically selected, Dr. Shock is, I don't know, let's say he's bred him and another superhero, a female. I don't remember if...
Oh, no, sorry. That wasn't Slav. That was Virago, right?
Yeah. And I don't recall if they were supposed to go into space or if it was just only one of the two. I guess it was only one of the two, because he was going to have to leave her behind. And they, he goes into space. And I don't know what he does. It's not clear from the story, unless I misremembered something, but he returns, you know, from the heavens, and everybody treats that as I don't know, just they, you know, they talk about him as the god of success. He's, you know, he's managed to go out into the unknown and come back, you know, potentially with knowledge, at the very least with the aura of the Messiah.
Yeah.
And society has as a consequence embraced him and as a Superman figure, and all the.
Go ahead.
Oh, just all the, and then it, you know, a lot of he's at the center of individuals' fantasies. All those women are like, want to have sex with him.
Yeah, and, a little fan, you know, expo. Yeah.
Yeah, and a lot of the men or some of the men want to be him. Or at the very least, some of the other superheroes or individuals with powers.
Yeah, I think that whole the space thing is like sort of like the moon mission on a grander scale, because they say he goes to the stars. I think it really isn't clear what he does in space, but yeah. But so as we find out, and there's that really great, a really cool moment where Marshal Law is confronting him. So he's at this like fan expo and he's you know, soaking in the accolades, and Marshal Law starts interrogating him and kind of cutting him down with everything. It's like, oh, like, what are your powers? Can you do you have X-ray vision? And then no, I can't do that. And he's like, well, can you at least read this? And he holds up a sign that says, oh, we haven't even talked about sleep fan yet, man. But
oh yeah, that's right. Yeah.
So this is pretty critical before, but anyway, he holds up a sign that says, do you go around with a bag on your head raping women?
Right. Shit. Yeah. Because, he does that. Yeah, there it is there. Well, can you read this? And I love the next panel. It's completely silent and the public spirit's eyes just go really wide. And he's just awesome. Like, fuck. Yeah. Yeah. But the story opens up, you know, and this gets back to the noir vibe that I get off of it, you know, like it's there's a serial killer on the loose, and he's out, and he's got Wolverine like claws. They go snick, but he's got a bag on his head, and flowing black robes. You know, like he's very 90s or mid 80s, dark, grim dark, and he kills women who are dressed like the public spirit's fiance, Celeste.
This is the dumbest, like, weakest serial killer type I've ever seen, I think.
Yeah, it's...
It's really fucking easy to avoid that.
Yeah, that's true.
Like Celeste.
Yeah, well, don't blame the victim, bro.
No, that's true. I definitely... Even so, like, in the first story, they're like, oh, they've killed, like, 3 go-go girls and, like, 2 prostitutes who are dressed like Celeste. And then following another... Like, I don't know, man. It just doesn't make a whole lot of sense.
No. But, you know, it really doesn't have to.
Yeah.
So, Marshall's got the idea that the sleeper, the serial killer, is the public spirit. And so he spends a lot of this story, you know, trying to bust him for.
Yeah, building a case, gathering evidence. And so that moment at the pedestal is sort of like him, like, just publicly confronting and shaming the public spirit. And afterwards, he gets jumped at this. It's sort of like an expo that Doc Shock has created to showcase all of his, you know, creations and the wonders of superheroes. But it's also sort of like a recruiting station where they, like, sign young kids up to be converted into superheroes. And he gets jumped by a bunch of superheroes and, like, they want to kick his ass.
Where is it? I closed it up. There's a quote that while he's getting jumped, or after he gets jumped. Yeah, okay. So this gets to what we were saying about his decency. The people attacking him, they're jumping him afterwards. It's like a 6-panel fight scene. So the first panel at the top, do you know what it would mean if your filthy allegations were true? Kane's the star of the space program, for Christ's sakes. Don't you care about your country? And then he beats them up for a little while, and then he's like, it's because I care.
Yeah.
And which, you know, again, this, you know, doubly gets back to what you were saying, because, like, that's stupid. But on the other hand, Yeah. But it's there, you know?
Yeah.
Anyway. So, and then the real allegation, aside from the accusation of being the sleeper, is that he had killed his ex-fiance prior to going off to the stars.
Which wasn't clear to me why he'd need to do that. Like, they wouldn't allow him to be part of the program if he was married or had a child. I guess because you would be coming back 20 years, 25 years later because of the time dilation effect of space travel.
Yeah,
I guess that's it. So you gotta drown your wife and be done with
and an unborn child, yeah.
Yeah.
Nothing
to do.
Yeah. And you know, and as it's revealed, he did actually do those things.
Yeah.
So he's a super piece of shit. But you know, like that's basically like, you know, that's one of the reasons this story works, you know, because like in The Boys, the only way that a story like this where the hero just gets to mercilessly hate and beat the shit out of the villains is if the villains are villainous, you know, like cartoonishly so.
Yeah. And that's vigilante comics in general. Like, you always have to have that. Like Batman, like if Batman doesn't have the Joker, if it doesn't have like irredeemably corrupt criminals, then it's just a billionaire beating on poor people. And that just doesn't work.
Yeah. You have to like, and either that or, you know, whoever's writing it has to ignore it, you know, like it's, and what's going on and just like accept it as a series of tropes and traditions that right. you present.
Although ideologically that's like super right wing and I mean blaming the poor for crime, but we can set that aside, I guess.
This is a good point for me to like, this story was very satisfying for me because I read a lot of comics. And a lot of them that I talk about have superheroes in them, but I fucking hate superhero comics.
And so
seeing, you know, generally speaking, and so this story, you know, really speaks to that attitude within me more so than The Boys did, because I thought I do want to talk about that one day. Like Garth Ennis is, it's all because they're perverts. And you know, they're just sex perverts, you know, it's a very weird, just a very weird angle.
That's a big part of it. But, he really gets into that angle of it. I do think that, the part that I like about The Boys, and I do find that it goes a bit far, but, the corporatization of the superheroes, like them as sort of like corporate shills is what I find really interesting about his take.
Yeah, and it's extremely timely, you know, like when he, like The Boys came out in 2001, something like that, 2002, which far predates the MCU and, you know, the acquisition by Disney and all that shit of Marvel properties and intellectual properties and the sort of Marvel geek world that we live in now. So, you know, good for him. Some of that stuff is here in Marshal Law, but I just find there's a lot more chew on in this story, and it allows me to really dislike the superheroes and have someone, you know, do the thing, beat them up.
It is satisfying.
Yeah.
Sleep Man is I guess pretty important. I guess we can just reveal that. So,
yeah, sure.
Marshal Law has one of my favorite lines in the series is like when he introduces Danny, who turns out is the Sleep Man, and he says, "This is Danny, my computer operator." He's just the guy who operates computers for him.
Yeah, but, just
just a sidekick who like does. I guess he does his research for him.
Yeah, I guess he is the sidekick, but he's in a wheel. You know, one of the ways that this story throws you off the scent is really just by hiding Danny in plain sight. He's in a wheelchair. He's kind of nerdy. But all the clues are there, like his reaction to superheroes, his strangeness, his, you know, he uses the word bacteria and filth. And, you know, if going back and looking at it again, you're like, okay, yeah, it's there. Yeah, but he is the sidekick. Yeah.
It's clearly, yeah, you're right. Like all the clues are definitely there. And like even his, it turns out that his mom is Virago, the woman who Public Spirit basically left for dead, so he'd go off into space with, and so she's a siren too, right? So like she, yes, like their powers are to warp people's minds, which me, like I think that's my second read through that I realized, because like Danny's origin is really weak. Like he's basically within the span of a day he becomes like he goes from like he's in school and like. His flies down and kids see his dick and then they make fun of him. So he goes from that to killing a homeless person to like being willing to kill anybody his mom says, because she's trying to groom him to be like sort of her instrument of vengeance against all superheroes, because he's born from two superheroes. He's supposed to have some kind of amazing powers. Like he can fly from birth, right?
Yeah, yeah.
His mom kind of like, it's the Norman Bates treatment. Like she's always kind of on him and like just kind of bringing him down, trying to get him to hide his power. So he grows up twisted and kind of all fucked up.
Yeah, and when his penis is revealed and they just, you know, elephant trunk, elephant trunk.
Yeah.
And I'm just looking at a panel of him. He's like, he's just, his eyes are sunken and they're all wide. And there's just ha, 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 ha all around his head. And he's just like, it just breaks him. And yeah, everything about this story, and this will get what, you know, what Lynn's about later. It's all about penises. It's all about sex. It's, you know, like this, you know, and I guess maybe this contradicts what I said about Garth Ennis, where he was like, it's all about sex. So, you know, like, okay, same with this story as well. But
it's different, though. It's different in its intent. Like, there's still a lot of phallic imagery, and I think it's sort of like meant to be like about overcompensation and things like that.
Yeah, it's very Freudian in a way that Ennis would have no interest in. Yeah, for him, it's, you know, there nothing. It's not the, nothing's about sublimation or desire or you know, fucking. Anyway, it's not nothing Freudian. But in this, you know, that's pretty much the whole shebang.
Yeah, and part of Lynn's thesis too, yeah. Right? That the public spirit's all about dominating, and like, you know, everything he does is about like. There's a great, I think I wrote it down somewhere, but just she's talking about like some speech he gave, and everything's about like thrusting forward and all this stuff, and it's just like,
yeah, yeah,
over the top.
Yeah, he's got a big missile between his legs.
Yeah.
I'm looking at it right now. I found it under my pillow, and it's under her pillow. You know, because he's having a flashback. She's been murdered because she was dressed like Celeste at a protest. Yeah. And then the sleeper kills and rapes her, you know, in classic. Bad. Yeah, no, I. but you know, it's women in refrigerators. It's a trope in the, you know, like, I don't know if that's. I don't think it's Pat Mills being insensitive in this moment, although there's many moments in this story where he's insensitive. I think it's just like that's what you're supposed to do in a story like this. I'm not sure if I'm giving him too much credit, but.
No, I think you're right.
Yeah. I don't know. I would have to.
Go ahead.
Oh, no, I just have to read more of his other works. You know, maybe it's part of maybe it's a pattern. I don't know. I just feel that it's not, whatever.
Yeah. I did think so. I mean, I'm amazed. So that scene, so as Lynn died, like, so she goes to a protest, dressed as a Celeste to protest the fact that she dresses overly sexually. But she goes with these two guys who are basically like just jock, like frat assholes, right?
Yeah.
And they're basically there to like check out. So like when she like is in her costume, they're kind of like eyeing her, and she gets pissed off at them. But basically, she says like, "I just wanted to protest with you guys because you're always talking about changing the world." So she she's doing a feminist protest to impress a bunch of guys who are just like assholes.
Right.
That is amazing to me. Like, that's such a what a moment.
That didn't even occur to me.
It's not a good look.
Yeah. And yeah, and then she's murdered for her troubles.
And even as she's running, she's like, oh, bad things don't happen to me. And that's like really all the defense she can mount. So like, it's not like, I almost feel like issue 6 is like a retcon of the character. Like, because she doesn't have that. Like, and the way she's presented in issue 6 is like her thesis is like very intelligent and articulate. And I do like the fact that she's kind of changed Joe's mind about superheroes. And like, you know, he actually listens to her criticism of what she has to say.
Yeah, yeah. I guess it's one thing I'd say to that is so that internal dialogue of hers while she's being attacked, and you know she's I remember her. Yeah, she's like, you know, these things don't happen to me. I think what I got from that moment was not that she was being foolish or selfish or anything. It was more like one of those moments of stark realization where the myth of safety. The myth of sorry, I'm still collecting my thoughts on this. Basically the myth of safety, you know, it actually doesn't apply to her, you know, and she's about to be killed. I don't know if that works. It might work.
It's a reading. Yeah, I mean, it's possible to read that moment, but I don't know. I think they probably got caught up in just wanting, like, so they were in a satirical mode. They want to make fun of everything. And, like, so they're trying to make fun of these guys. And, like, they just, like, led to some bad writing. I mean, I'll give it a pass just based on what they, like, where the series goes, like, where this arc goes. But.
Yeah, because at the end, like, I was really taken with the final issue of this story, especially, you know, when. He's, you know, her thesis is being read in the background amongst all the action, and it ends, you know, him walking away from her funeral, her grave, I guess. You know, and I mean this like literally, it was strangely touching. It really shouldn't have been something that you know gave me the feels at the end, but I was just, you know, because he's like the whole story. He's talking about how he's never found any heroes, and then all of a sudden he's like, you know, now I know where to find one. I don't know, that's cheesy, but it did.
No,
it
I
like
it
me.
Too.
Yeah.
Yeah. So he's like, so yeah. Marshal Law goes to confront the wedding of Celeste and Public Spirit, and he's gonna finally put him away. Like he's quote unquote proven that this is the Sleep Man, but it's actually Danny and his mom who are behind it the whole time. They're trying to manipulate. Marshal Law to be the fall guy. He figures it out. He ends up understanding that Danny is a Sleep Man, and so they kind of escape and duel, and Public Spirit and Virago kind of have it out. He ends up killing her. Danny wants revenge, but like Marshal Law just like it's very anticlimactic. He just shoots him like it's one shot guy's dead. So which is not totally the case, because like I really like that. So he's very consciously playing with that idea of like, you know, in superhero comics, like no one's dead until you've seen the body. So Marshal Law waits for a long time to make sure the guy doesn't come back up for air, but he's taken anyway, right, to be restored.
Yeah,
and that's a cool
I did appreciate that. I was looking for something while you were talking about that. Mm-hmm. I'm still trying to find Lynn's murder. Yeah, I don't know if I'll ever find it.
It's issue 2. It's towards the end of that.
All right. Well, I don't want to get too distracted. It is kind of anticlimactic. And then Danny, you know, while Lynn's thesis is being read, Danny is, and this is so weird, Danny's presented with, you know, like, do you want the, you know, the Razor Mother, or do you know, it's very Grant Morrison.
I was thinking that myself. It's totally Grant Morrison.
Yeah. Or do you want
like, the soft mother?
Yeah. And he's like, I choose Marshal Law. He's like, ma, but which mama, Danny? Marshal Law. And yeah, you know, he's a sidekick even at the end.
Yeah, I didn't know what that was about, man, but I laughed at it. So
yeah. Yeah, that's pretty much, yeah, like this, and this gets back to what you were saying about, you know, it's a B plus or whatever, or I, or maybe you said B minus, I forget.
B minus.
Because, yeah, like so much is going on, but it never really totally coheres. Like, I don't understand the purpose of that last Danny scene. And what does it mean for Danny to select Marshal Law, and what does it have to do with the thesis that's being read out loud and the final climactic battle between Marshal Law and public spirit?
Yeah. All I can think is that, so if you're always being presented a choice in the society between false alternatives, so like either like good and evil are essentially meaningless because everything is corrupt, then yeah. Marshal Law is a third way, I guess.
And it's super appropriate. It's super appropriate that you called it the third way, because fascism referred to itself as the third way.
Is that right?
Yeah. Between capitalism and communism.
There you have it.
Yeah. Fuck. Yeah. So yeah, Danny's chosen the third way. Whatever.
I really don't feel that. Like, for the reasons I said, like, I think Joe at his heart is able to differentiate, like, even though he talks about how he doesn't care, like, you know, you might call me a fascist, that's fair enough, but yeah. Like, I think it's all like sort of like, it's, he's like the guy who punches Richard Spencer in the face. He doesn't care if it's right or wrong, he's just gonna do it. Like, mm-hmm. he's just gonna like fuck up some Nazis, like, and like, and he doesn't care about the image of it, right? Like,
I don't think that yeah, sorry, when I was saying the third way being fascism is, you know, I'm not, I think we hammered home pretty clearly that Joe is, you know, if not a decent guy, then at the very least his alter ego and some of the things that he has to say suggest that, you know, he's operating from a place of, I don't want to say good faith, but, you know, he's not a bad guy in a completely insane world. He has heroic qualities. I don't know. I don't know. Is there anything to say about Lynn's thesis itself other than it's, you know, it's pretty obvious. I like how it's laid out.
Go ahead.
No, go on.
I just love the imagery. So it kind of deals with these trading cards that were produced as propaganda. Like, I'm looking at it right now, the public spirit, job well done, conquering the stars, no more slums. He's kind of like bringing people homes, like literally like lifting homes to like, faces.
Yeah.
But then she contrasts them with these sort of like almost like underground comics sort of like alternatives, and they're really like gruesome and like really amazing. Like Home for Christmas is this like disintegrated corpse in a coffin, and like After the Battle or like people are like dealing with radiation poisoning and pissing out blood and stuff like that. It's really
destroying a dog.
Destroying a dog, yeah. That's so fucked.
And actually the contrast between undergrounds and above grounds, as I guess they would say, you know, between your corporate superhero Marvel DC comics and I don't know, and then the reality of violence and warfare and human evil below all of it, you know, and obviously it's they even allude to it, you know, it's like in Vietnam, there's the image of Vietnam, and then there was, you know, for a large extent the reality of Vietnam.
Good point. And those propaganda trading cards look very like they're very Superman, like they're very intentionally kind of like in the sort of like Superman aesthetic.
Yeah absolutely. So yeah, and she's, you know, she goes at length talking about how, as you had already said, it's overcompensation, it's about penetration, it's about fear of communism. Yeah, communism as homosexuality.
Yeah. domination.
Right. And so, you know, like the superhero fantasy, which was developed in the war and mutated and served ideological purposes in the, you know, the initial anti-communist push, you know, like Iron Man. Go on.
No, I was just going to say, you're consistently reading this in a sort of like meta comics sort of way, which makes a lot of sense. So the history of comics being tied into propaganda and in war in World War II. Yeah, I hadn't thought about that.
Well, then also even after World War II, as I was going to say that Captain America and Iron Man were, you know, they fought communists. You know, they'd fight the Russian threat. There would be, for a while prior to the 70s, like that's a lot of the stuff that was going on. But then in the 70s, it started to, you know, like the criticisms of war and Steve Englehart and all those guys. But still you can't ignore that history. And this story seems to want to embrace some of that and use it as part of the message that it has.
Definitely.
Yeah.
I just want to say go ahead. Were you going to say something?
No, I didn't have, nothing else.
Say that the fight, like, for all of my criticisms about sort of the action in this, like the fight between Marshal Law and Public Spirit in the last issue is pretty fucking awesome. When he punches right through that, like, cop's chest and, like, leaves him a mangled, like, heap as he's on the run from Public Spirit, from Marshal Law, rather. It's really, some really horrific imagery.
Yeah, it's the best fight, and it makes like I was saying earlier in the story, a lot of the action's incomprehensible. But yeah, I can follow this great. It's perfectly paced. It's like he had, I don't want to sell this story too much, too short. But it's like really issue six is the thing that he wanted to make, and everything up into this was just him putting the pieces in place, which is what most stories are. But usually, it just feels a little more like that. With this series. Yeah.
There's also the really interesting moments, I thought, and I think that this again is like sort of like a criticism of, maybe not direct. I mean, I may be making too much of it to say it's a direct criticism of Frank Miller.
Yeah.
But just the part where like they're talking about how, like, you know, the macho sort of attitude and, like, you know, like heroes can't ever cry, and like it's like, so Public Spirit's like mocking him that like Lynn died and all this shit. And like Marshal Law starts to weep, and he's like, and Public Spirit says, "That's right, cry, you wimp, you fairy fighter. You anyone can tell from looking at you that you're." And he says, you know, like some pretty offensive things about homosexuals. And then, but anyway, so it's like, it's that moment of him just kind of revealing his, well, he's revealed his true stripes a lot in this, but just that idea of like, I mean, the whole sort of like vigilante comic is all about being as strong as possible and like unbreakable as possible. And it was interesting to see Marshal Law depicted as someone who is able to weep at something like that.
Yeah. He's getting to the Punisher, you know, like the Punisher never wept. He just punished, you know, where Marshal Law, he'll weep, he'll mourn. He'll miss Lynn, in a real sort of way. The Public Spirit, when he's shot with, I don't know, is he shot with a gas or a gun or something that makes him reveal his greatest fear, or something like that?
Yeah, it's the doctor. The Batman villain. Help me here.
It's a Scarecrow.
Scarecrows, yeah, it's like his gas.
Yeah, and so it's impossible. No one can be a Superman. No one, you know. And then he's all pathetic, and he's like, "But I did my best." And then Marshal Law quotes Abraham Lincoln at him. yeah. So he hits rock bottom, and then so it looks like he's going to show weakness. It looks like he's going to spill the beans about the reality of the myth, and then the authorities blow his brains out.
Yeah, a sniper takes him out.
Yeah. I was looking for the trial for this piece of shit. Yeah.
And the corrupt commissioner says, heroes are a lot less trouble when they're dead. Go ahead.
Well, I was just going to say, it just ends on a really, and this gets back to the Chinatown thing, just it ends on a really cynical note where it's just like the system's going to maintain, you know, like public spirit may have been broken, but he'll be stronger as a symbol than he ever was in life. You know, like we're going to, you know, he'll be Abraham Lincoln. And then Marshal Law, he says goodbye to Lynn. And you just get the impression that he's just going to go out and continue to be Rambo on a leash for the system.
Yeah, and the final panel, in fact, like the last thing you see is the newspaper, and it shows the public spirit saying, it says Nation mourns its greatest hero. And then Marshal Law is like line that he says all the time, I'm a hero hunter. I hunt heroes. I haven't found any yet.
Yeah.
Which got old, I thought. But anyway.
Yeah. Even once would have been enough, but needed to be a regular refrain so that way at the end, he could tack on that bit about Lynn, you know.
Yeah.
But yeah, and so he walks away. And there were a lot of other Marshal Law stories. This trade paperback that I have is like more than only half the story is the six issues that we read. And then, you know, they came back and they made fun of superheroes again and again and again. But I haven't read them.
Okay.
They look pretty wild, though.
Does Danny appear anymore?
I don't think so. No, later on. The next one's a one-shot where he goes to Manhattan, and it's very clearly Marvel superheroes. And they're in an insane asylum, and I think he's breaking in to murder all of them.
Okay, that's fun.
Yeah. It just seems like after this, it just like even just flipping through it, it just looked like they started dicking around, and it's a lot more like issues one and two. Maybe I'm wrong, you know, but it doesn't look like it's building. But I don't know if I would have. There's a goddamn penis space station. Yeah.
It's Jordowski.
Yeah. Yeah, so he did this for a while, up until the 2000s or so.
No shit. I'd honestly never heard of this. So, yeah, I'm glad I read it, though, for sure, because if nothing else, I had no idea that the boys came from something so directly.
Yeah, it was really even with my sense of what the story was going to be, it was pretty shocking to see that. But then, you know, like we already said, it, you know, it makes a lot of sense. I mean, they're all coming out of 2000 AD, and I don't know, now's the time.
Yeah.
I don't have anything else.
No, I think that covers it for me, too.
All right, cool. All right, man. Well, this has been James and Chris. We've been talking about, I don't know, did I introduce you? Maybe I'll have to tack something on at the beginning. Who gives a shit?
I can't remember.
This was Marshal Law, and we're signing off.
Thanks for listening. If you like what we're doing, tweet us at XtinctionA or drop us a line at extinctionagenda6@gmail.com. Otherwise, feel free to leave a favorable review on iTunes or whatever podcatcher device you're using. See you next week.
Now, all we need is a little Energon and a lot of luck.